The duty to protect sets the goal for us to end intimate partner violence, trafficking, child abuse and neglect. But ending these forms of violence is one thing. The way to achieve it is another.
In our research, we found that women and children, young adults who have been trying to escape violence, especially if they come from a migration or minority background, often have the experience when they go to general institutions that they're not listened to, that they're not taken seriously, they aren't really believed. And this is very hard on them. It's very difficult to disclose violence in any case. And then to have people simply send you away or say, no, your mother couldn't have done that. Or we've talked to your husband, he's really nice. That stops them from seeking further help for a long time.
We found that a lot of professionals become less confident when they start to think about working with someone who's from a different heritage or culture than them. And they're faced with this question, do I treat them the same or do I treat them differently? And this is something that we've explored within our project.
The woman or the young adult who has experienced violence isn't believed until they go back a second time with a specialized support person. And that, of course, makes them feel very weak and not respected again. So this is a real problem that authorities who authorities with the power to grant benefits often think that they have to be sure and examine whether someone is believable. They develop what is called a culture of disbelief, whereas it's essential to encounter a culture of belief to be able to disclose violence and actually escape from a situation in which the woman, the child, has been told anyway that everything they say is worth nothing and no one will believe them.
Well, if I start at my very beginning, the first help I attempted to get was through a local helpline. They were absolutely useless. They just told me to go back and face my husband. They didn't question me or allow for the possibility that it could be abuse. I tried that probably 6 or 7 times over a period of 4 years. And I really feel cross because as a Muslim woman, you tend to think nobody's going to believe me, nobody's going to accept me. I also tried my general practitioner and said I was feeling down. I was referred for counseling. The counselor listened to me, but did not name what I was experiencing as abuse or refer me anywhere. But she did get me to acknowledge that I was acting out the stereotypical role of a controlled Muslim woman. I had experienced child abuse, so I didn't know it was wrong. It was just the same as living at home. I did see a poster in the GP surgery, and it was talking about if your partner shouts at you, makes you feel uncomfortable, makes you feel inferior.
Ich finde es wichtig, daran zu arbeiten, dass das Erleben von häuslicher Gewalt kein gesellschaftlicher Makel mehr ist. Dass Frauen dazu stehen können, dass sie betroffen sind, weil sie keine Sorge haben müssen, dass sie dann stigmatisiert werden. Und mein zweites Anliegen ist, ich finde, wir sollten vor allen Dingen betroffenen Frauen zuhören und sie fragen, was sie denn möchten. Also uns vielleicht mit Ratschlägen zurückhalten, sondern eher Hilfestellung dabei anbieten, rauszufinden, wo möchte ich denn hin.
É evidente que a maior parte das dificuldades advém das consultas terem período muito curto. De facto haver muitas vezes mais médicos na sala que dificultam esclarecer perfeitamente a situação. Muitas vezes vêm também acompanhados de outro familiar, mas eu penso que aqui a questão mais importante e que mais dificulta a ação dos médicos é eles nem sequer terem o hábito de inquirir quando vêem situações que podem estar ligadas, de facto, à violência, de se sentirem à vontade, de perguntar e de darem a entender à vítima que podem ser um ponto de apoio para ela depois poder manifestar outras circunstâncias ou explicar melhor o que se está a passar.
But then, I think because I was often late in school, a social worker came to me one day and talked to me and asked if I was feeling all right at home and if I wanted to tell her anything. She said she wouldn't tell anybody else. So I told her of my missing bed and not getting any food and stuff, and that I had been already in the youth welfare office, but they hadn't really helped me. She asked me if she should go with me to the youth welfare office again, and she brought me there, but I said she mustn't come in with me. So I talked to the youth welfare office alone again, but nothing happened again. Then my father told me my whole family was going to move to Leipzig, and he didn't want me to come with them. I was going to look for myself after they left and see where I could live. So I went to the school social worker again, who went to the youth welfare office with me, and talked to them with me. And that was the first time they were really listening to me, and they took me seriously. They don't really offer you enough time to talk or offer you real help, I think. They only really listen to you if an adult is accompanying you.
Temelj torej našega sodelovanja je medsebojno zaupanje. Velikokrat ugotavljamo, ne, da posamezne službe, recimo bodi si šolske svetovalne službe ali telo vzgojiteljico v vrtcu, da ko zaznajo ta sum, da včasih se počutijo nemočne, imajo dileme v zvezi s postopki, kaj se bo zgodilo, pojavi se strah pred tem, ali bodo udeležene v nadaljnih postopkih na sodišču, strah pred maščevanjem, grožnje, pomisleki so tudi, kaj če to ni res, ali svojo prijavo lahko s to informacijo, s tem obvestilom lahko škodim otroku. Želja je morda tudi po minimaliziranju, kaj in tako naprej, ali imam za to dovolj dokazov. Ne? Tu se pojavi veliko teh strahov in dilem glede tega, ali kljub vsem, da imamo ustrezno zakonodajo, ali to informacijo potem posredovati ustreznim inštitucijam, recimo bodi si centru ali policiji.
Ich finde, dass Kinder in bestimmten Prozessen von viel zu vielen Menschen befragt werden. Ich finde, dass das viel mehr geschützt werden muss und würde dafür noch mal ein Plädoyer gerne erheben, dass Kinder einfach mehr von den Leuten befragt werden, die auch dafür ausgebildet sind.
Then I made my statement to the police, and the policeman I talked to was very concerned. He explained to me what I was allowed to carry with me for my self-protection, and he came to my workplace each week, and he always inquired whether everything was okay with the children. That's how I understood that they were protecting me, and that they had not found the perpetrator yet. Well, to me, this meant there was someone who was taking care of me and protecting me. Then they caught him and he was put on trial. I was very much concerned and worried because it was very difficult to remember and to explain everything in detail after 1 year had passed. At court, the interpreter was not so good. But I was pleased about the female lawyer's considerable engagement because I was so upset and worried. I was unable to eat all day long, and then I began feeling sick in the courtroom. But they all stood by me.
For me as a support worker, when I'm dealing with an individual who we believe is a possible victim of human trafficking, it's really important to ask questions that can lead us on to assess risk. I call those the trigger questions. So it'll be things like, how safe do you feel here? And how safe would you feel when you go home? And I'd also mix that in with a bit of scaling. So 1 being very frightened or 10 feeling very safe. And from that, then we can do a correct risk assessment and see where we go with the information and then refer on to the relevant agencies.
Ich als Anwältin und Nebenklagevertreterin erlebe in den gerichtlichen Hauptverhandlungen häufig das Problem, dass man ein Spannungsfeld erkennt zwischen Interessenvertretung der Frauen, der Zeuginnen, die ja eine Aussagepflicht haben, und dem Strafverfolgungsinteresse. Und das muss ich dann zum Teil so lösen, dass ich immer jeweils eine Entscheidung treffe: Ist es nötig, meine Mandantin jetzt wirklich zu schützen vor bestimmten Befragungen? Oder ist es nötig, sozusagen der Strafverfolgung Vorschub zu leisten? Und ich denke, die Zeuginnen haben einen ganz harten Weg vor und hinter sich, wenn sie sich dieser Befragung stellen. Und ich sehe es als ganz nötig an, dass wir noch mehr Opfer- und Zeuginnenschutz in die Verfahren mit hineinbringen. Es müsste viel mehr von der Möglichkeit einer Videovernehmung Gebrauch gemacht werden können, von einer richterlichen Vernehmung, sodass die Zeugin nicht mehr in der Hauptverhandlung sich den Angeklagten und den Fragen der Verteidigung so stark stellen muss, wie das hier heute noch der Fall ist. Liliano, Moment, Liliano, ja, Stanirano.
In what sense is it the same? Is it the same only in terms of rights? Or is it the same in other ways about how you approach someone? Do you need to approach them differently? Do you need to pay attention to issues to do with language, to do with what violence means for them, for someone from their background? Does it mean the same thing? Does it mean different things? And what does it mean for survivors? What does it mean for someone who has experienced violence, but to experience it in a context which is different from the one that they're familiar with, where they don't know how systems work, where they don't know what their rights are, when they've come from somewhere where you don't trust state agencies? Maybe they've come from somewhere where there are no NGOs. So what do all of these things mean for how we do interventions around violence and how we create safety and freedom for those who've been victimized?
One time he beat me so much that he broke my teeth and my face became deformed. I went to the police that time. The police officer said, "He's in his country, in his home. If you're not well, go back to your country." The police officer also treated me as if I was a prostitute. The justice system here is very racist. At some point, I went to an institution looking for help. They didn't do anything. The only thing they wanted me to do was to leave home and go to a shelter, but that's so unfair. He's the one who should leave the house. In Portuguese society, there's a lot of prejudice against Brazilian women. They treat all Brazilian women as if they are prostitutes.
Postopek pa mora biti po moji oceni, kar se tiče tožilstva, enak, ne glede na to, kdo stori kaznivo dejanje, zoper koga je storjeno kaznivo dejanje. To omogoča tudi pravno varnost ljudi, ki morajo vedeti, kaj je kaznivo dejanje in kaj je kakšno ravnanje prepovedano.
Dileme pri migrantih ali pa pri kakorkoli drugačnih ljudeh se pojavijo že čisto v osnovnem stiku. V moji stroki v družinski medicini gradimo odnos na komuniciranjem besednem in nebesednem. Besedno komuniciranje je pri ljudeh iz določenih dežel, čigar jezika ne poznam, zelo, zelo ovirano. Še huje je, kadar so to ljudje, ki so na kakršenkoli način zakriti, včasih tako, da ne vidim niti oči in mi je še nebesedna govorica skrita. takih primerih moramo ravnati z vsem spoštovanjem, z vso obzirnostjo, z vso rahločutnostjo in po vseh zavezah moje službe, mojega poklica in Hipokratove prisege. Ta velja za vse ljudi na svetu, ne glede na barvo kože in jezik, ki ga govorijo.
Delo s pripadniki romske skupnosti zahteva eno tako, kako bi rekla, lastno samozaslišanje, kako jaz vidim in kakšne so moje prepričanja o pripadnikih romske skupnosti, kakšni so moji stereotipi. Ker jaz ne poznam pravila delovanja v njihovi skupnosti, je pa to edina skupnost, ki je za njih dobra, ki njih sprejema. Vso varnost in vse potrebe zadovoljuje v tej skupnosti. Zato mislim, da strokovni delavci, ki delamo na področju nasilja v družini, ves čas moramo imeti samo govor sam s sabo. Ne? Kje so moje ovire, da ne uspemo spostaviti odnosa, delovnega odnosa z uporabnikom. In največkrat je ta ovira za vzpostavitev delovnega odnosa moj stereotip. Ali neustrezen pogled na nasilje, ali neustrezen pogled na kulturo, ali moje obsojanje tega vedenja in moram ves čas biti pozorna na sebe. Ne samo na uporabnika, ampak na sebe, kaj jaz delam.
Liljano mome, Liljano, jaz danirano prizori, jaz danirano prizori.
Next day, she took me to social services and left me there. The people were nice, but I didn't understand the language, so that was a big problem. They took me to some hostel. It was evening by then, and I hadn't eaten. So I went out to get some food, and when I came back, the doors were locked, and they had to come back to let me in. Then my social worker took me to a place. We had to go on the train, and this place was part of the home office. But when we got there, my social worker left. She said she had another case. I didn't understand what was going on. I was alone there. Sometime later, there was an interpreter, and I had an interview, and after that, someone took me to another house.
Wenn wir in Familien möglicherweise Risikohinweise haben, dass es eine mögliche Gefährdung gibt, bei Familien mit Migrationshintergrund sind alle, die nach SGB VIII arbeiten, verpflichtet, sozusagen nach den ersten Hinweisen Fallberatung zu machen, Fachteam zusammenzurufen und danach einfach zu gucken, mit den Eltern ins Gespräch zu kommen. Und dieses kann manchmal eine größere Hürde sein, da die Familien ja, da wir als Profis nicht normale Kommunikationsmittel nutzen können. Wir können häufig nicht anrufen, weil da die Sprachbarriere da ist. Wir können keine Einladung zum Brief, keinen Brief schreiben, um sie einzuladen, so dass es manchmal schwieriger ist, dass Fachkräfte an die Familien herankommen.
I think there's a danger that cultural issues can be set really apart or constructed as really other, when there are perhaps a number of lenses that professionals look through during a case. So if there's a very young mum, a lens might be about how her age, her youth, perhaps her inexperience is relevant to how she's worked with, how that should be accounted for when thinking about her views about parenting and so on. Similarly, culture might be another lens. What are the issues that a family or a parent's cultural heritage raise? How is that significant to how they're worked with, what they understand about parenting and good enough parenting and risks and so on, that it's just one of many several lenses is really my point.
Liljano mome, Liljano, jaz danirano prizori, jaz danirano prizori.
I was arrested 2 times because I didn't have any documents. I was detained in the police station during the night. I was working with other women in the streets and we were all arrested. During the 2 times I was arrested, I was very afraid of being sent away back to Africa. Some women were sent away. The police officers didn't inform me about my rights, but they didn't treat me badly and gave me food. I slept in a cell with my colleagues. we had the right to an officially appointed lawyer whom we didn't have to pay. And she asked if we wanted translation to English, but we didn't want that. The lawyer defended me well. At the court, I was treated well and released both times.
For a non-EU a potential client of the service or potential victim, it's difficult, it can be difficult in the first instance, because if you are trying to help them to come into the service, the difficulty is we only can support them for a temporary period of time, which is a minimum of 6 weeks and a maximum of about 3 months. And the issue is what we can't do in order to get them to come into the service is promise safety, indefinite safety, because if they're under immigration rules, so a non-EU national will not have the right to stay here without making other applications such as asylum.
Dileme okrog stvari, ki sicer pri večinskem prebivalstvu ne bi bile sploh tema. In tak tipičen primer so recimo zame še vidno romske deklice in dvojka romske deklice, ki se jo tudi v strokovni javnosti pač predpisuje temu, da gre za neko specifiko tega kulturnega okolja. Za nas je pa to prodaja otroka, ne glede na to, a gre za romsko kulturo, a gre za večinsko kulturo. Ne? Če bi šlo za primer večinske kulture in bi bilo 13-letna deklica, ki bi jo nekdo hotel poročiti, tudi neformalno, ne da bi gre za neformalne poroke, tukaj ne bi debatirali o tem, je to stvar kulture ali ne, te družine. Ne?
Yes, one of the things that is very shocking about the UK government's current concerns to prevent health tourism, as it calls it, and, you know, prevent foreigners, or people with lack of immigration status, availing of our health services, is to impose very punitive charges on people without immigration status. Now, it is true that they have made an exception for victims of trafficking, but the problem about that is it's only after they've had a reasonable grounds decision from the competent authority, which is the Home Office, the same people who throw people out of the country. And secondly, only before they've had a conclusive grounds decision. If that is negative, we will of course challenge that negative decision, but in between times, they will find themselves landed, our poor clients will find themselves landed with a big fat bill for thousands of pounds, maybe because they had a baby or because they were in need of very urgent medical treatment, which now they find they're having to pay for.
We can't just say to the woman or the child, behave and follow us and do what we say. They want to have a say as well, even if we try to do them good. And this causes a lot of questions. We have to think about when it is appropriate to share information, to intervene, even without consent. What level of consent do we have to achieve? A lot of questions arise from the questions around self-determination.
The violence lasted and intensified for 10, 11 years. Then once, when I was home alone, he severely beat me and kept me in the apartment for 3 whole days. I managed to negotiate him allowing me to call the kindergarten where I worked to say that I wouldn't come to work. The head of the kindergarten suspected something and informed my daughter, who came to the apartment and asked a neighbor, who is a police officer, to to intervene informally and talk with my husband, which he did. Then he finally let me go, so I went to see the doctor, who told me that I needed to report it to the social work center, which I did.
Največja dilema je pa takrat, ko uporabnik ima drugačno pričakovanje od mene in jaz ne vidim sebe v tem pričakovanju, no, in ne morem ustreči temu pričakovanju. Ko se postavim v situacijo, da jaz sem tista, ki presojam, kaj je za uporabnika dobro. Ne? Kdo sem jaz, da odločam o tem, kaj je in kakšno življenje naj bi imel drugi človek, ne? In koliko je tukaj njegova avtonomija, da on odloča o tem, kakšno življenje bo živel in pravica, da o tem odloča. In mislim, da za nekoga, ki dela na Centru socialnega dela in ki se srečuje z življenjskimi zgodbami, ker Centru socialnega dela je institucija življenjskih zgodb in to takih težkih življenjskih zgodb, je modro imeti čim manj tako neprepustnega filtra v tem, da jaz točno vem, kaj je prav in kaj ni prav. Ne? Ampak da sledim uporabniku in sprejemam tisto, kar je za njega prav, ne? In da se prilagajam njegovemu prav.
Often the reason why women don't give their consent is because they're concerned about what will happen with their children, housing, finances. And if women were provided with a lot more information about their legal rights, about the support and services that are available to them to assist with their children issues, housing, finances, and any other concerns that they have, you may find that they may give consent or that they can make a more informed decision about whether or not to provide their consent.
So wie wir das ja im Prinzip haben, dass wir eben ganz viel auf die Freiwilligkeit, auf die Mitwirkung der Frau setzen und dass wir feststellen, uns sind dann die Grenzen an der Stelle gesetzt, wo die Frau dann auch nicht mehr mitwirkt, an dem Punkt, an dem sie nicht mehr will, an dem Punkt, wo sie nicht zur Beratung geht, nicht das Telefon anruft, die bei der Polizei nicht mehr kooperiert, bei der Staatsanwaltschaft nicht mehr kooperiert. Und wir dann eigentlich in allen Professionen feststellen, dass an dieser Stelle dann Grenzen gesetzt sind und wir dann nicht mehr weiterkommen und das Ganze dann stockt. Und alternativ dazu könnte man sich ein System vorstellen, in dem es eben sehr viel direktiver zugeht, in dem sehr viel mehr auch gegen den Willen einer Frau möglich gemacht werden würde, die Strafbarkeit von häuslicher Gewalt noch anders geahndet werden würde oder man eben dann auch Schweigepflichten außer Funktion setzt und wie auch immer, um dann quasi auf diese Weise der häuslichen Gewalt mehr Herr zu werden. Die Gefahr ist natürlich darin zu sehen, dass man dann zunehmend auch Frauen verliert oder Familien verliert, die dann eben halt tunlichst weggucken werden, nicht mehr an die Öffentlichkeit gehen, es nicht mehr melden, nicht mehr bei der Staatsanwaltschaft Anzeige machen, keine Beratungstelefone mehr anrufen, weil sie sich eben quasi auf die Vertraulichkeit nicht mehr verlassen können oder auch auf ihr Recht, diesen Prozess auch selbstbestimmt sozusagen zu gestalten, sondern befürchten muss, dass ihr dann die Fäden aus der Hand genommen werden und sie das selbst nicht mehr im Griff hat, wie das Ganze sich sozusagen weiterentwickelt.
As agencies, whether you're an NGO or a statutory organization, you have so much power, whether we like it or not. We have power in terms of what decision the woman makes to some degree or what information we give her. And I think the whole thing around consent, is the consent really there? Even when women give consent, what are they giving consent to? Because they're only giving consent to you at that point of you acting for them or for you supporting them. So every step that you take in terms of putting interventions in or contacting a particular organization, is that being fed back to women? And I kind of wonder, as organizations, do we really do that? How much information do we feed back to women? And can women truly give consent? Are they really giving consent for all these agencies to start looking at her and judging her in terms of how she is or isn't protecting herself and the children? So I think it's opened up more questions for me than answered in terms of consent.
Unser Ansatz oder mein Ansatz an der Stelle ist es ja auch, die Frauen letztendlich davon zu überzeugen, dass es ihnen gut tut, sich zur Wehr zu setzen, in welcher Form auch immer. Das überlasse ich den Frauen natürlich selbst, aber sie selbst müssen sich im Grunde dafür entscheiden, das auch zu tun.
Und ich glaube, dann braucht es manchmal so einen Impuls von außen, weil die das nicht selbst merken und da nicht selbst rauskommen, braucht es so einen Impuls und der geht manchmal ganz gut über den Kinderschutz. Oft Ist das so der Impuls für die Frauen, irgendwas zu verändern? Dass sie sagen, für mich selber kann ich das aushalten, aber wenn meine Kinder das miterleben, da ist für mich eine Grenze.
At some point somebody has to make a decision about protecting the life of the victim. So at some point somebody has to make that decision of what am I going to do, how am I going to do it, where am I going to share this information and who is actually going to protect this woman.
One day, when I was 4 years old, the kitchen window was open and I was sitting on the table so that they could see me from outside. I believe they kicked the door in or something. And then they wanted to take me with them and they grabbed me and my mother pulled me and screamed, "Let her go, let her free." And I was screaming as well, "Let me go." I mean, I didn't know who they were and I was crying. One of them just said then, "We're good for you. We don't want anything bad." And then they took me to their car and told me they were from the youth welfare office and were there to get me out of my family. I wasn't even allowed to take any personal stuff with me. Then they brought me to the youth welfare office and there they told me to choose a book and look at it. But I didn't want anything and was just sitting there crying.
Ich möchte sagen, dass die Familienhelfer von den freien Trägern in diesen Fällen immer unter einem besonderen Druck stehen. Sie haben die Verantwortung zu gucken, was in den Familien passiert, haben das Kinderwohl im Blick, gleichzeitig den Kontakt zu den Eltern und spüren für sich selber eine sehr hohe Verantwortung und bringen diese Verantwortung mit in die Teams, in die Arbeit und dann ist es oft sehr wichtig, in den Teams auch mit dieser Verantwortung, mit dem Druck umzugehen. Und die Erwartungen von Außenstehenden sind häufig sehr hoch, nach dem Motto, da ist doch eine Hilfe drin und die muss jetzt. Und dies muss ist manchmal eingeschränkt an den, oder gekoppelt an den Willen der Beteiligten.
Pri intervenciji v družini je moja največja etična dilema, kako dalje vstopite v družino. Kako daleč poseči v intimo družine. To je ta prvi pomislek, ki se pojavi. V praksi kaže, da različno vidimo otrokove pravice, da različno vidimo tudi zaščito otrok in da tudi različno vidimo, kaj je to kršitev integritete. Za mene je kršitev integritete tudi klofuta, ki se da otroku.
Also für mich als Familienrichterin zeigt sich immer wieder, dass im europäischen Kontext, jedenfalls was die Rechtsprechung des EuGH angeht, die Elternrechte wesentlich höher bewertet werden als die Kinderrechte. Also ich lese in den Entscheidungen immer nur, dass die Elternrechte so wichtig sind und mir fehlt, dass geguckt wird, was eigentlich die Rechte der Kinder, Menschenwürde, Persönlichkeitsfreiheit bedeuten und dass die mehr Berücksichtigung finden.
Acho que a lei que está em vigor, que é a lei 147/99, tem bem estipulado como é que se pode proteger as crianças. Temos a situação passa praticamente sempre por consentimento dos pais para a nossa intervenção. Naturalmente, situações complicadas, muito graves, em que a criança corre mesmo perigo. Mesmo se os pais não consentirem, nós, comissão, podemos atuar a retirar a criança do perigo. E nesse caso é retirada, é colocada num lugar seguro, pode ser numa familiar, pode ser numa instituição, pode ser numa pessoa idónea. Nessas alturas o processo segue para o tribunal e o tribunal tem 48 horas para dizer se concorda ou não concorda com o nosso procedimento.
Ja, bei aller Prävention finde ich persönlich das ganz, ganz wichtig, nicht zu unterschätzen, was für einen Druck die Kinder ausgesetzt sind und da eben ganz, ganz behutsam mit umzugehen, sowohl in der Verhandlung als auch ja, in der Betreuung, auch im Nachgang. Also die Kinder, die so einer Sache ausgesetzt werden, so einem Verfahren ausgesetzt werden, fühlen sich grundsätzlich schuldig. Und da muss man die Kinder nach und nach von befreien, indem man sie therapeutisch auch auf jeden Fall begleitet. Das ist ganz, ganz wichtig.
I think one of the things that are really important is to build up a trust with a child. But it can become a dilemma when a child discloses something that we know we have to report to the authorities, and sometimes a child might feel betrayed by us because we've actually had to disclose something to social services. And then if it becomes a child protection case and social services get involved, the child then feels they've been betrayed by us because they have to go home and they've said something about their parents. So it can be a quite tense relationship after that at times, and we have to try and explain to them in a way that they'll understand that we work in their interest to make sure that they're safe and they're protected, and that we do this for the right reasons.
I did not know who to ask for help. I was told never to contact the police as they would arrest me. Then I became sick and had to go to the hospital. They told me I was pregnant and so I had to keep appointments with a midwife. One time, late in my pregnancy, I had been badly beaten and locked in a room. I rang the midwife to tell her I could not make the appointment because I was bleeding and feeling dizzy. Then I fell unconscious. When I came to, the police were there. They said the midwife had called them and asked them to check upon me. They took me to hospital. I was in the hospital for 5 days, and during this time, I told the midwife I did not want to go back to the house again, but that I had nowhere else to go. She asked me why this was, and so I told her what had happened to me. After that, a police officer came and I was afraid. I said I had not committed any offense, and I begged her to let me go home to the house. The police officer told me that was not how things were done in this country, that if they let me go home, there was no knowing what would happen to me or the baby. So they said no, and the midwife said no, and said they have to call the social service people.
Wir sind für die Bekämpfung des Menschenhandels zuständig. Und das wird in solchen Runden immer vergessen. Also das Gefühl habe ich. Weil niemand spricht über die Zuhälter, niemand spricht über die Männer, die da hingehen, sondern immer nur über die armen Mädchen, die auch wirklich schlimm dran sind. Das will ich nicht abstreiten. Aber wir können nur arbeiten, wenn wir die Mädchen dazu haben. Wenn wir die Mädchen dazu bringen, uns Aussagen zu machen über das, was ihnen passiert ist, wie sie dazu gezwungen wurden, wie sie nach Deutschland gekommen sind. Und wenn das nicht passiert, können wir kein Verfahren gegen Menschenhandel machen.
Yeah, I was talking about the consent of an individual or maybe the victim of trafficking and how important that consent might be. And clearly it is very important, albeit it can't be the only consideration. In my experience, you have to have regard to the wider public protection implications. So there will be occasions upon which you have to almost disregard that consent, bear it in mind, but disregard it, because there may be other issues that need to be addressed, as I say, from a public protection issue.
Jaz kot oseba se lahko vedno vprašam, ne, a jaz škodim tej osebi, ki noče biti žrtev trilomije, ne? Kar tudi mogoče ravno z tega tudi to doživljam lahko na sodišču kot tako, ne? Da se neko osebo vpraša, da je žrtev, jaz trdim, da je, ona pravi, da ne, ne? To je seveda, da je velika dilema, zakaj.
Das ist schwer, das ist sehr schwer. Wir versuchen deswegen nicht nur im Bereich der Repression was zu unternehmen, sondern auch aufsuchende Arbeit zu machen, indem wir alle Bordelle, den Straßenstrich, die Wohnung aufsuchen und schauen, dass wir die Frauen antreffen, mit ihnen sprechen können, dass wir sie beraten können und hoffen letztlich dann einfach nur, dass wir im Extremfall dann von ihnen, wenn sie es denn brauchen, auch das Feedback bekommen, dass wir für ein Strafverfahren brauchen. Aber Fakt ist genauso, wir halten das im Regelfall nicht. Nicht, weil wir das Vertrauen nicht haben, sondern weil die Motivation der Frauen schlichtweg eine andere ist. Die einen wollen Geld verdienen, einige wollen, wenn sie denn Hilfe brauchen, auch einfach nur aus dieser Situation heraus. Das Interesse, ein Strafverfahren durchzustehen, ist ein ganz anderes und das haben die meisten nicht. Nicht mal dann, wenn man sie darauf aufmerksam macht, dass sie möglicherweise ja auch anderen Frauen damit helfen könnten.
It's the barrister's code of conduct. We're trained on it in bar school. There's various other aspects, but one of the key parts is fearlessly representing our clients' best interests
And obviously, as we discussed in some of the conversations earlier, best interests is an interpretation itself. But that's very much the key, that it's my lay client's best interest rather than trying to bring to justice particular perpetrators of trafficking. I need to consider very much about what's best for my clients at all times.
Jaz mislim, da je to tudi problem, ne, da se žrtev lahko prepozna kot žrtev, če mi delamo z njo, če imamo možnost delati z njo na dolgi rok. In tudi mi imamo v bistvu v zvezi z žrtvami neko predstavo. A ne? Se pravi, imamo neko stereotipno predstavo, kaj žrtev, kdo je žrtev. Ne? Ali pa še boljše, kaj pravzaprav žrtev potrebuje. Vprašanje pa je, če žrtev tudi sebe, če svoje potrebe dojema tako, kot vidimo mi njene potrebe. Ne? In meni se zdi pa zelo pomembno in tudi moje vodilo pri delu, ki ga jaz upravljam, je to, da jaz sledim potrebam žrtve, ampak potrebe pa meni v bistvu ljudje sami povedo. Če hočemo dolgoročno neke učinke z žrtvami trgovine z ljudmi, je treba v bistvu na nek način dela z njimi na dolgi rok. Mi damo osebi možnost vstopati v nek odnos z nami, z organizacijo, ki izvaja program zaščite žrtev, in ta odnos je drugačen. Žrtev vstopa v ta odnos in se v tem odnosu začenja počutiti varno. In ko se počuti varno, lahko potem vse te stvari v zvezi z samoprepoznavanjem, v zvezi z temi stvarmi, ki so globlje notri v njej, prihajajo na dan.
The most helpful thing anyone said to me was that I can make it on my own. They showed me the way and I did it myself. That was very important for me, that I can make it on my own.
This NGO was a great help to me and to the kids, as no one demanded anything from me. Everything I said was all right. I could feel one way or the other. The therapist was really good. She supported me and stopped me when it was needed and said, Sylvia, this is important. This is not okay. This is okay. She offered me another perspective. I never felt discriminated against. I was very well treated. They treated me in the same way the others were treated. I maintained my relationship with the shelter staff and they helped me to this day. After the second aggressor, they asked me if I wanted to go again to the shelter. I declined. I didn't want to start all over again. They helped me a lot. Went to court with me, for example.
They got me another solicitor to sort out my immigration, and now I'm able to stay here for 5 years, which I'm very happy about. And here, everyone treats you the same. Even in the house with the other women, all different cultures, all different people come together, and we can talk to each other. Whatever country you are from, here you're treated the same. So now I can say, even though I have been trafficked, I haven't controlled that situation, and now I want to be able to speak out. I want to be able to help more women in that situation.
I had no idea that it was possible to get so much help, that the police would help, that such establishments as an expert advisory center exist, and that everything could be arranged somehow and so rapidly. I didn't know about all this before, and how the police dealt with me. That was very good, very, very good. And how they treated me when I made my statement and everything I told them, things that I'm mostly ashamed of. That took days. They treated me so nicely. I even had a private mobile phone number with the crew. he said, I could always know if something should happen. And also later.